Everything is beautiful in its own way. Like a starry summer night, snow-covered winter's day. Everybody's beautiful in their own way. Under God's heavens, the world's gonna find a way. There's none so blind as he who will not see. We must not
Church of Christ, and greeting to everyone here. We're going to do the call to worship in English and Spanish this morning. So please allow a little extra time so that the Spanish can be done before the responses. And if you care to, we'll surely do the response in your native tongue.
Tengan ustedes un buen día. Mi nombre es Samuel. Estamos felices de estar una vez más en la casa de Dios. Un día domingo, 15 de abril de 2018.
Like the disciples who met the risen Christ. Remember to pray for respect.
Al igual que los discípulos que conocieron a Cristo resucitado.
We come with our questions and doubts and listen for Christ to appear in our midst, saying,
"Peace be with you."
Venimos con nuestras preguntas y dudas y escuchamos a Cristo aparecer entre nosotros.
Touch me and see who I am, says Jesus. We look around as the lives of our neighbors and guests.
Tócame y mírame quién soy. Dice Jesús, observamos las vidas de nuestros vecinos e invitados.
And we seek the power of the risen Christ at work there, offering peace, offering hope, offering courage, and offering transformation.
Y buscamos el poder de Cristo resucitado, trabajando allí, ofreciendo paz, ofreciendo esperanza, ofreciendo coraje, ofreciendo transformación.
We are only witnesses to the tangible love of Jesus. Come on, let us worship.
Unidos en el espíritu y inspiración por la gracia de Dios, bienvenidos todos, amamos a todos y buscamos la justicia para todos.
And now all please the reading of our UCC mission statement. United in spirit and inspired by God's grace. We welcome all, love all, and seek justice for all. And now, if you're able, please rise and send a hand of personal friendship to your neighbors. Peace the Lord be with you.
I delight to do your will, O my God. Your law
within my heart. I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation. See, I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord. I have not hidden your saving help within my heart. I have spoken your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from this great congregation. Amen.
Amen.
Desired or taken pleasure in sacrifices and offerings and burnt offerings and sin offerings, these are offered according to the law. He then added, see, I have come to do your will. He abolishes the first in order to establish the second. And it is by God's will that we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. The word of God for the people of God.
Be seated.
Well, good morning once again, everybody. Nice to be back. Nice to be here. Thank you. Glad to be here. Before I sing this song, actually, I thought I would do something a little different today. When David Dunlap asked me if I would come today, I said, of course, I'd be thrilled to do. It's always a pleasure. And then I got an idea. So a lot of you know that Mr. Dunlap has been a part of a dynamic team called Dunlap and Pennington, right? Very well. What you might not know is that before he was with Dunlap and Pennington, he was with me. This gentleman, Pennington, worked at a group called the Songs of Broadway, and we traveled around the world for like 10 years singing together. And I thought it would be really fun if he would join me and sing with me today. So please welcome Wesley Pennington.
So lost that Jesus could not own.
at night. A woman sick with cancer fears she'll lose the fight. A home that is divided by bitterness and pain, and a world that is still searching for a clear and better way.
System. The best animals and the best grain were offered to God. There were burnt offerings, grain offerings, sin offerings, guilt offerings, the offering of ordination, the sacrifice of well-being, and my personal favorite was the scapegoat. where all the community's sins were laid onto this poor goat, and he was sent out into the wilderness. Offerings were made for the atonement of sins, for well-being, for sinning unintentionally, for being guilty, for touching something unclean, for swearing, and for not speaking up when you should. There was a lot of cutting up of animals and blood splashed on everything. And in class, I remember sitting there thinking about the small town where I grew up, and I thought about the processing plant, and I thought about the smell and the flies, and in the heat, it was so much worse. And I only remember thinking was location, location, location. You did not want a house on the side of the temple. You really didn't. The temple was destroyed and the sacrificial system came to an end 2,000 years ago. For Christians, the resurrection was a game changer in regards to sacrifice. The work of Jesus changed the paradigm. Jesus is the sacrifice for us. Now there is grace. We can ask for forgiveness. We have an open communication with God. So that led me to making the case for sacrifice today. What is the relevance of sacrifice in 2018? We still offer to God our talents, our gifts, our time. We sacrifice for a greater cause. We sacrifice for love. We sacrifice to help others. We sacrifice for justice. We sacrifice for relationships. It's always give and take. One person doesn't always get their way exclusively, or they shouldn't. We sacrifice to achieve goals that we set. Sacrifice is hard work, and it takes effort. And the texts today tell us that our sacrifice is doing God's will, and that pleases God. And that leads me around to asking, how do I know what is God's will? How could we possibly know that? And there's a prayer that I pray that I found early in my discernment process many years ago that I'd like to read that speaks to this. It's by Thomas Merton. It goes like this. My Lord God, I have no idea where I'm going. I do not see the road ahead of me. I cannot know for certain where it will end. Nor do I really know myself. And the fact that I think I'm following your will does not mean that I'm actually doing so. But I believe that the desire to please you does in fact please you. And I hope I have that desire in all I am doing. I hope that I will never do anything apart from that desire. And I know that if I do this, you will lead me down the right road, though I may know nothing about it. Therefore, I will trust you, though I may seem to be lost and in the shadow of death, I will not fear, for you are ever with me, and you will never leave me to face my perils alone. Amen. God's will. How do we know God's will? We follow Jesus' instruction. Throughout his ministry, Jesus teaches us how to be disciples. We please God by showing mercy to everyone. We live by these words. I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. And these words. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Sacrifice is not only the action, but it's also the intention behind the action. How you live is important. Actions speak louder than words. That should be my motto. Actions speak louder than words. How many people can you think of whose grand words are meaningless when their actions are reprehensible? Brother Lawrence, from the 1600s, would worship God through everyday tasks. Whatever he was doing, he did to the glory of God. He would say it wasn't the sacredness of a task, but it's the intention behind it. He made his everyday work tasks a sacrifice to God. And there's also an element of spiritual surrender when you talk about God's will. And when I say spiritual surrender, I don't mean surrender as in hands up, as in giving up. I mean surrender as an active decision to place yourself in God's hands, to let go and let God. In the Methodist faith, there is a covenant prayer, a prayer of surrender that's done on New Year's Eve every year, which goes like this. I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing. Put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you. Exalted for you or brought low for you. Let me be full. Let me be empty. Let me have all things. Let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. And the covenant now made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. Almost 12 years ago to the day, actually, this happened. Samuel was a week old. Samuel was my youngest. And we went for his 1 week checkup. And he'd been having some problems holding his milk down. The doctor immediately realized he was dehydrated and sent us straight to the emergency room. They admitted him to the hospital, giving him fluids and setting off to discover the why of why he was dehydrated. First, he was allergic to milk. Then he was allergic to soy. In the meantime, his lab work had started to take a turn for the worse. Specialists were called in, geneticists, and in Tennessee, you do not want geneticists called in. You do not want to trace your family tree. You should never have children. But they were called in. Renal specialists were called in, and they could not explain what was going on with Samuel, but he was continuing to lose weight. He was only 5 pounds when he was born. But Samuel and I were in the same room in the hospital for a couple of weeks, and I had my Bible up there, and I was reading from Samuel, his namesake, and I read Hannah's words of giving her son to the Lord, and I was moved. And through tears and through prayer to offer Samuel to the Lord. This was beyond me. It was beyond the doctors. Lord, Samuel is yours. Your will be done. Samuel was sleeping peacefully beside me as all this was going on. And I continued to read and got to the end of the passage I was reading, and the words that I was reading came off of the page of the Bible and into my heart, and the passage said, and the boy Samuel continued to grow in stature and in favor with the Lord and with men. And I don't know why, but I felt a great relief, like those words were meant for me. Personally, that message was for me. And not but for a few minutes later, Samuel's nurse came in to weigh him. And she came back excited, and for the first time, he had gained weight. It was a minuscule amount, but it was a gain. Amen. And the doctors came in later that evening, and his blood work was improving. And you guys have seen Samuel now. He continued to grow. There was something about surrendering to God, turning it over to God. Really, it was never in my hands anyway. I only thought it was. In the glow of Easter, what do we sacrifice? What gift do we bring? Amen.
Merciful God,
You gave your only Son to be both a sacrifice for sin and an example of godly life. Help us gladly to receive all that He has done for us and follow in His footsteps. We pray a special prayer for our world leaders. May they find the joy that you provide in all others. May they make decisions with love as the foundation of their words. We pray for those with special challenges. We speak their names out loud. We sing the prayer taught to us by your Son, Jesus.
Surgery, we were able to facilitate people to be with her. When I got there, her amazing family was with her, did not leave her. That is the power of prayer in United Church of Christ. Giving of time. George Brown had a vision of a garden of memories. He brought it to the board. As you leave today, please look as you go into Elliott Hall. The transformation that place is taking. People have donated their time, their generosity, their treasures. Today is a deadline. We had two people come forward. We met the first $5,000 match. We have another $5,000 match today. We need about $1,800 to fulfill the last of that. This is how our church reaches out. Time, talent, and treasures. And based on the needs of this congregation, we had two individuals step forward for the Health and Justice Ministry, Suzanne and Kathy. In your bulletin, you will see this information. Please read it, please fill it out, and please get a part of this. And we know that prayer changes things. Priscilla and her prayer ministries. We are a church of faith. Look at the communion table, the heart. United Church of Christ. We are a place of love. To God be the glory.
Thank you.
sacrifices may they be holy and acceptable in your sight. Amen. Here at the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, all are welcome at God's table. All who hunger to know the love of God are welcome to commune here. All are invited to experience Jesus.
Let us pray together. Creator God, we come to your table asking to write your laws on our hearts. Forgive us when we hide your righteousness. Forgive us when we cower from serving you faithfully. Strengthen us through this holy meal to demonstrate your love and gentleness when we take action consistent with your will. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. touched today by God's love and grace while viewing our worship service, and we hope to see you in person one day. We at the United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale, are an open and affirming church that believes in equality for all. We have many ministries that reach out to the needs of those in our community, and there's always something here for everyone to be involved in. We believe that God is still speaking and that our ministry outreach can only continue its vital mission in bringing people to Christ through the support of people just like you. Please visit our website, uccftl.org, for more information about us, to submit a prayer request, or even donate to the church if you have been moved by the Spirit. You will help us in God's work in our ministry outreach. We look forward to hearing from you soon, and we hope to see you next week. May God's peace and love be with each and every one of you. And remember, God is still speaking.